Suzanne.
Obdrzalek. And we are going then to listen to Cynthia Patterson.
Yes,
good pronunciation. And then Marcelo Boeri. And for the first communication, we are going to listen to Suzanne Obdrzalek about the extended sound in Plato's Phaedo, because this morning it's all about body and soul and the link between body and soul. So I give you.
Thank you. It's such an honor to be here. The soul occupies and takes up space. It has both location and extension. Not only that, but it can move through space. It is capable of causally interacting with matter by making contact with it. And such contact can cause matter to adhere to the soul so that it becomes visible and heavy. Plato, I shall argue, commits himself to exactly these claims in the Phaedo. Collectively, I refer to them as the theory of the extended soul. To those of us schooled in post-Cartesian philosophy, this can come as something of a shock. Isn't matter defined via extension? If so, how can Plato, as a dualist, maintain both that the soul is immaterial and that it is extended in space? Considerations such as these have led numerous interpreters to dismiss passages in the Phaedo that appear to commit Plato to the above-mentioned claims as overblown metaphor. Bostock, for example, writes, quote, "Obviously this interpretation of the Phaedo is absurd. It treats the soul as if it were made up of some quasi-material stuff. It is not what Plato meant to suggest at all." Gallup observes, quote, "Unpurified souls are described in terms that could not literally apply to the soul in its essential incorporeal nature. How could an incorporeal thing be interspersed with a corporeal element, be weighed down, or fall back into another body and grow in it? Such language taken literally describes interaction between one material substance and another." And Hackforth, commenting on Plato's depiction of the philosopher's soul as constricting away from the body at 67C, writes, quote, "This is perhaps the most materialistic language used by Socrates about the soul in the whole dialogue. Taken literally, it would imply the spatial diffusion of a sort of vital fluid throughout the body. But of course, it must not be taken literally, but rather as vivid metaphor." The few interpreters, such as Robinson and Wolff, who do not dismiss these claims, either do not offer a sustained discussion of them or treat them as pertaining only to select portions of the dialogue. My aim in this paper is to reverse this trend, to offer a careful analysis of the theory of the extended soul as it appears in the Phaedo. In the first part of my paper, I argue that what has driven interpreters to dismiss passages that appear to advance the theory is a fundamental misunderstanding of how Plato conceptualizes matter. They assume that as an immaterial substance, the soul cannot be spatially located or extended, but this is not how Plato conceptualizes body and matter. Such interpreters also assume that the extended soul theory, taken at face value, is absurd, and that interpretive charity demands that we not attribute it to Plato. I argue that, whether or not we find the theory absurd, it is clear that Plato did not, since he develops a theory along exactly these lines in the Timaeus. In the second part of my paper, I sketch out some of the explanatory advantages and deficits of the extended soul theory, and I conclude by turning to some of its ethical ramifications. Before I turn to these arguments, we should first take a closer look at the theory itself. To begin, I will list some of the claims Plato makes that suggest that he subscribes to the theory. First, Plato proposes that death is due to the soul's departing from the body. Thus, in the final argument, he writes that, quote, "When death comes to the man, the immortal part departs, going away safe and undestroyed, making way for death. Upon departing from the body, the soul is described as proceeding to another realm. For example, in the recollection argument, Plato claims that recollection, quote, would be impossible if our soul didn't exist somewhere before being born in human form. In the affinity argument, he describes the soul as making its way to a place noble and pure and invisible. Conversely, life is due to the soul's entering the body. In the final argument, Plato writes that, quote, soul, whatever it occupies, always comes to that thing, bringing life. Collectively, these claims imply that the soul has a spatial location, that it is capable of changing its spatial location, and that its capacity to animate a body is due to its being located inside it. Second, in describing the relation of soul to body, Plato implies that the soul can become attached to the body. Thus he laments that the soul cannot achieve truth so long as it is, quote, kneaded together with the body, and advises the philosopher to purify his soul by avoiding, quote, communion and contact with the body, and, quote, accustoming the soul to gather itself together and collect itself by itself from all sides away from the body. The souls of those who are overly attached to the corporeal are alternately described as tied, bound, glued, and nailed to their bodies, and as filled and infected with its nature. Collectively, these passages imply that the soul is capable of contact with the body and of becoming attached to the body. The images of the non-philosophic soul being kneaded together with the body and of the philosopher's soul contracting away from the body indicate that the soul is extended throughout the body. Finally, Plato claims that excessive contact with the body causes a corporeal element to attach itself to the soul, causing it to be reincarnated. Such a soul is, quote, interspersed with the corporeal, with which it has grown together due to the soul's communion and intercourse with the body, through always being with it and on account of its great concern for it. This soul, quote, exits full of body so that it falls right away into another body and grows in it as if it were sown there. In sum, the core commitments of the extended soul theory are the following. 1, the soul has location in space. 2, the soul has extension. 3, the soul is capable of locomotion. 4, the soul's interaction with the body involves contact between soul and body. 5, this contact can cause a corporeal element to become attached to the soul. And 6, the soul animates a body in virtue of its occupying the body, and it ceases to animate a body as a result of its exiting the body. What then has caused my opponents to reject the theory of the extended soul? What motivates them are certain assumptions about how Plato conceives of matter. They assume that matter is defined as what is located in and extended in space. Since Plato treats soul and matter as distinct substances, passages where Plato appears to treat soul as possessing these properties must be merely figurative. The first thing to note is that it is not clear how sharp Plato takes the opposition between soul and body to be in the Phaedo. Granted, in the affinity argument, he divides being into two classes and aligns body with the class of the visible, changeable and divisible, soul with the opposite. However, in the very same argument, he depicts souls that devote themselves to corporeal pleasures as becoming visible, heavy, and even corporeal. This in turn implies that the opposition between soul and body may not be entirely straightforward. While Plato distinguishes soul from body in terms of its being imperceptible and changeless, these do not appear to be properties that the soul necessarily possesses so much as qualities that it can aspire to. Furthermore, when we carefully examine how Plato does characterize the soul-body opposition in the Phaedo, it emerges that at no point does he develop this opposition in terms of the bodies being located and extended in space. Instead, the opposition centers on the bodies being perceptible, earthy, and heavy. In the affinity argument, Plato distinguishes two forms of being, one visible, the other invisible, and maintains that the body is more akin to the visible, the soul to the invisible. He later refers to the body as the visible part of us, the soul as the invisible. What about how Plato characterizes the corporeal more generally? At 81b, he refers to the somatoi des, the corporeal, as what one can touch, see, drink, eat, and use for sexual pleasure. At 81c, he writes that the somatoi des is weighty and heavy and earthy and visible. And at 86a, Simmias calls the lyre and its strings somatoi dei, corporeal, and visible. Or sorry, somatoi dei, composite and earthy. Perhaps to be maximally charitable to my opponents, we should open up our discussion to Plato's entire corpus. If Plato defines matter in other dialogues as what is located and extended in space, then perhaps they can be justified in applying that definition to the Phaedo. What emerges is quite the opposite. In the Sophist, Plato presents the materialists as identifying soma with what affords contact and touching. In challenging the materialists, he implies that soma is what is visible and touchable. In the Statesman, Plato claims that the nature of body is such that it cannot remain in the same state. In the Laws, Plato lists belief, care, intelligence, craft, and law as the things that are akin to soul, hardness, softness, heaviness, and lightness as belonging to soma. In the one passage that does offer support to my opponents, he lists habits, customs, will, calculation, true belief, care, and memory as pertaining to soul, bodily length, breadth, depth, and strength as pertaining to body, suggesting that spatial attributes are distinctive of body. However, against this, as I shall discuss, in the Timaeus, Plato presents the soul as extended in space, though possibly lacking depth. In the Timaeus, he claims that whatever is visible, tangible, and possessed of a body is perceptible, suggesting a connection between being perceptible and being corporeal. He later argues that whatever is generated must be, quote, corporeal and visible and tangible. Nothing is visible without fire, nor tangible without something solid, nor solid without earth. This passage again suggests an association between being corporeal and being visible, tangible, and solid. At 46D, Plato contrasts body and soul. Whereas earth, air, fire, and water are visible bodies, soul is an invisible thing. Finally, at 53C, Plato writes, quote, "It is clear to everyone that fire, earth, water, and air are bodies, and all body has depth. And it is completely necessary that what has depth be enclosed by plane figures. And the rectilinear nature of the base of a plane figure is composed of triangles." What emerges from these passages is that Plato analyzes soma along the following lines. One, soma is perceptible. Two, it is either composed of or identical to earth, air, fire, and water. Three, it is necessarily subject to change. Four, it has depth construed as being made of elements composed of rectilinear planes. Conversely, when we turn to Plato's treatment of soul, we do not see him claim that it is to be distinguished from body by its lacking location, extension, motion, etc. The final argument of the Phaedo suggests that soul is to be defined as a principle of life, while the Phaedrus and Laws highlight its role as a source of motion. Nonetheless, my opponents might counter that, even if Plato does not distinguish body from soul in terms of its being located and extended in space, capable of motion, etc., to attribute such properties to soul is absurd. Interpretive charity therefore demands that we not take Plato seriously when he appears to make exactly these claims. But here we should be careful in how we deploy the principle of interpretive charity. It is not enough that we should find the theory of the extended soul absurd. To be justified in dismissing the textual evidence suggesting that Plato subscribes to this theory, we would need to demonstrate that he would find the theory absurd. But in fact, we have decisive evidence to the contrary, since he develops a theory along exactly these lines in his later dialogue, the Timaeus. In the Timaeus, Plato proposes that, just as the body is made up of some stuff, earth, air, fire, and water, so the soul is made up of some stuff, portions of being, sameness, and difference. In the case of the soul of the universe, this stuff is clearly extended in space, since it is stretched throughout and around the body of the universe. Further, as numerous interpreters have emphasized, the soul of the universe engages in thought through its rotational motion. In the case of human soul, our souls are divided into three parts, corresponding to the tripartite division of the Republic. Plato lays great emphasis on their specific corporeal locations. The rational part is located in the skull, since this conforms best with its rotational motion. Spirit is separated off from reason by the neck, so as to stay in reason as little as possible. It is placed between reason and appetite, so that it can act as reason's auxiliary in controlling appetite. Furthermore, it is placed near the heart, so that it can communicate with the entire body through the blood vessels. Finally, appetite is placed below the diaphragm so as to further separate it from reason. In all of this, it is striking just how specific Plato is in assigning bodily locations to the parts of the soul, and how these locations are justified in terms of either enabling or preventing the soul parts from making contact with one another and with the bodily organs. All of this implies a contact model by which the parts of the soul interact with one another and the body. This contact model is confirmed by Plato's account of perception, which he analyzes in terms of the motions of external objects being conveyed through the body to the soul. There are, of course, significant differences between the Timaeus and the Phaedo, but my point is not to suggest that we can import the psychology of the Timaeus wholesale into the Phaedo, but rather to argue that since Plato clearly assumes the extended soul theory in the later dialogue, we ought not to dismiss passages in the earlier one that suggest that he subscribes to it there as well. My opponents, of course, wish to dismiss the passages that support the extended soul theory as mere metaphor because they take the theory to be absurd. Ultimately, the reason I believe we should resist this move is that the theory is not absurd. On the contrary, it offers Plato significant explanatory advantages. In the first place, the theory provides Plato with a neat explanation of the unity of body and soul. One's soul belongs to one's body because it is located inside it. This is tied to the theory of animation and death that Plato advances throughout the dialogue. The body is animated when the soul enters it and dies when the soul exits it. The soul animates the body by causing the movements and change constitutive of life for the organism. This brings us to the second advantage of the extended soul theory. It offers Plato an explanation of soul-body interaction. Soul and body interact by making contact with one another. Though Plato does not spell out the details of how this occurs, as Brody, Johansson, and others have noticed, it is at least less problematic that an immaterial soul should causally interact with a material body if we take the soul to be located in space, extended, capable of locomotion, etc. Before continuing, it is worth pausing to note how these explanatory advantages are lost if we reject the extended soul theory. If we take the soul to simply be some center of consciousness or willing without spatial location, then we are left with the question of what makes that center of consciousness belong to a given body. It will not do to claim that a given soul and body constitute a unity because of the soul's affective attitudes towards that body. For the non-philosopher's soul never ceases to love and desire his body, yet this too ceases to constitute a unity upon death. Now, Plato's repeated claims that the soul enters and exits the body are difficult to dismiss. Perhaps my opponents might try to help themselves to the claim that the soul is unified to the body by being located inside it, while denying that the soul is extended and capable of contact with the corporeal. But this inevitably leads to the following question. Why should Plato require that the soul be located inside the body in order to animate it, if he does not hold that it causally interacts with the body through contact? If the soul could cause the body to move by simply willing it to, then there would be no reason why the soul must be located inside the body in order to animate it. I have argued that for Plato, soul and body constitute a unity in virtue of the souls inhabiting the body. However, Plato also holds that souls and bodies can be unified to varying degrees. While even the philosopher's soul is unified with his body while he is alive, the souls of non-philosophers can become considerably more entwined with their bodies. Through repeated and extensive causal interaction, their souls eventually become enmeshed with their bodies. Plato reflects this when he refers to their souls as nailed, glued, and grown together with their bodies. As a result of this intertwining, upon death, the non-philosopher's souls depart with a corporeal accretion. This corporeal accretion, in turn, forces the soul to re-enter another body. By contrast, the soul of the philosopher, which has minimized its contact with the body during life, is able to depart without a corporeal accretion, and hence to avoid reincarnation. In this pure state, it is able to fully grasp the forms. Thus, the final advantage of this theory of the extended soul is that it plays a key role in Plato's defense of the philosophical life. My opponents maintain that this talk of a corporeal adhesion is merely a colorful way of representing the soul's persisting desire for or identification with the body. But should we interpret Plato that way, his argument begins to fall apart. Consider, for example, the passage at 67a to b. Plato writes, quote, "While we live, we will come closest to knowing in this way, if as much as possible we do not consort or have communion with the body, insofar as it is not completely necessary, and do not infect ourselves with its nature, but purify ourselves from it until the God himself releases us. And being pure, by being freed of the folly of the body, it is likely that we shall be with like company, and shall know through ourselves all that is pure, and this is presumably the truth. For it is not permitted that impure should grasp pure." Here, Plato appeals to a like-knows-like principle to explain why devotion to the corporeal should render us incapable of grasping forms. But what explanation is left if we abandon the extended soul theory? What does the philosophic soul's purity consist in, such that it resembles and hence is able to know the forms? It will not do to equate the purity of the philosopher's soul with his devaluing or not identifying with his body, since such psychological states cannot possibly offer a point of resemblance between his soul and the forms. Despite its explanatory power, the theory of the extended soul is not without difficulties. Due to constraints of time, I can only touch on these. In the first place, supposing that the soul is incorporeal, what is the mechanism by which it makes contact with the corporeal? Plato simply does not provide an answer to this question. Perhaps this is because it failed to puzzle him. In the Laws, while discussing how the soul of the sun causes it to move, Plato considers three possible explanations. First, the soul being inside this body that appears round carries it just as our soul carries us around everywhere. Second, being furnished from somewhere outside with a body of fire or some air, as some people say, it pushes a body by force of the body. And third, barren of body, but having some other exceedingly wondrous powers, it guides the sun. Two things are noteworthy here. First, Plato identifies the first option with how our souls move our bodies. Our souls carry us around in virtue of being inside our bodies. Second, he does not treat this as mysterious. It is the third option, where the soul moves the body from the outside, that he describes as involving, quote, exceedingly wondrous powers. A second set of difficulties concern the mechanism by which the soul becomes unified with or separated from the body and the specifics of how it is affected by the corporeal accretion. According to the theory of the extended soul, a body becomes a living organism when a soul enters it, a corpse when the soul exits it. But what causes the soul to enter or exit the body? The soul's corporeal accretion is at least partially responsible for embodiment, but what is the mechanism at work? And what causes death? At the conclusion of the dialogue, we see in vivid detail death move through Socrates' body. But what is the mechanism by which the hemlock causes his soul to depart? And finally, I have proposed that the corporeal accretion prevents the soul from knowing the forms due to some sort of affinity requirement. A soul that is grown together with a corporeal element cannot know the incorporeal forms. What sort of model of cognition is at work, such that knowledge requires prior affinity? A final set of difficulties has already been given careful discussion by Wolf, namely that there seems to be some sort of explanatory redundancy at work. On the one hand, Plato emphasizes the role of the corporeal accretion in making the soul impure and causing it to re-enter a body upon death. But at the same time, Plato offers an alternate psychological account. At 81b and 83d, he seems to equate the soul's being impure and corporeal with its believing that only the corporeal is real. At 82e, he further claims that the soul is imprisoned due to desire. These psychological strands in Plato's account have led interpreters such as Brody to maintain that the soul of the non-philosopher is bound to the body through self-identification and desire. While this is certainly part of the picture, we would wish to know more about how this fits with Plato's emphasis on the soul's contact with the body as the source of its impurity. I would like to conclude by briefly considering the implications of the theory of the extended soul for the ethics of the Phaedo. Recently, there has been a controversy concerning how to interpret the asceticism of the Phaedo. Proponents of the evaluative interpretation maintain that Plato does not require that we abstain from bodily pleasures. It is sufficient that we should devalue them. By contrast, those who advance the ascetic interpretation argue that Plato requires us to avoid bodily pleasures to the degree possible, since they necessarily distort our judgments, causing us to believe that the sensible world is both real and valuable. On either interpretation, however, questions remain. Why should engagement with the body necessarily distort our judgments? And why should these false beliefs render the philosopher's soul impure? On the theory of the extended soul, we have a ready answer. The problem with these false evaluative and ontological beliefs is that they cause the philosopher to devote himself to his body. This causes his soul to depart with the corporeal accretion. Thus, the theory of extended soul supports a strongly ascetic reading of the Phaedo. Even if it were possible for the philosopher to enjoy pleasures of the flesh while remaining aloof from them, the damage would already be done by the mere fact of his engagement with the body. That is not to say that the philosopher can withdraw from his body wholesale. Indeed, his soul must interact with his body, both in order to sustain life and in order to control the body. Tellingly, even in contemplation, the philosopher cannot escape the contamination of corporeal experience. In order to recollect the forms, he must begin with perception. Thus, even as the philosopher cannot help but engage with the body, he is left in the position of hoping that this engagement will not contaminate his soul. Thank you.
Thank you very much. That was great, very clear, and I think quite persuasive. I just want, you're criticizing your opponents, the other side here, for reading into Plato the Cartesian assumption about matter, this identification of matter with extension. But I'm wondering if you're not reading back into Plato another Cartesian assumption, which is the identification of extent of being in place with extension. And I'm not sure if we're not better off disassociating those two. So in other words, you present a lot of evidence, I think, to show that in some sense for Plato, the soul has a topos, right? But is having a topos for Plato being extended? Mm-hmm. Are those the same thing?
Yeah.
And of course, you know, the reason why the idea of the extended soul seems absurd to a lot of people is that then it raises questions like, well, you know, how many inches wide is my soul? 4 inches or 5 inches, right? So maybe your argument would be stronger if you didn't talk about an extended soul, right? This notion, got rid of this notion of extension,
yeah,
and talked instead about a soul that has a place. I'm not an elegant way to put this, but you know, place,
yeah,
soul.
Yeah.
So shouldn't we separate in Plato that notion of being in topos,
yeah,
from extension?
So really good question. I'm not assuming that what has location has to have extension. So I think, for instance, a point is something that has location, obviously no extension. So there are other reasons why I want to take this whole to be extended. I'll give you two of them. One, in the Timaeus, I think he's clearly committed to the soul being extended. So it's not, is this better? So I don't think it's something that Plato would reject out of hand. And I do see the Timaeus as further developing some of these assumptions that we see in the Phaedo. But secondly, it seems to me that he wants there to be degrees of contamination or contact between body and soul. And if the soul's a point, it seems hard to give an account of how there could be more or less contact with the body, right? The soul, it would just make either contact or no contact, it would be binary, whereas if it's extended, it could be the case that it has more or less contact. Also, some of the language in the Phaedo about being meted together or contracting away from the body, again, to me suggests extension.
I'm here. Thank you very much.
What is your name?
Laura.
Laura.
Yes. In contemporary philosophy of mind, the word extended is a technical term. I'm thinking, for example, by a seminal paper by Clark and Chalmers. So my question is, if you take this term in a technical sense or not, and then why you use the word extended and not embodied or embedded? So I ask you this just to understand the difference.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you.
So I haven't read the paper by Chalmers that you're thinking of, but I believe you're, I might have you wrong, but I believe you're thinking of the one where he talks about the extended mind, meaning that, for example, I don't know, my phone might count as part of my mind because some of my mental states are represented there or something like that. I don't mean it in that sense. By extended, I just mean it takes up space.
Okay.
Now, the second question was, why do I use the term extended and not embodied? Because those are two different claims. So one claim I'm making is the soul is inside a body. The second is that it takes up space.
Hi, Suzanne.
Hi.
I think that you're assuming that this skedaste ousia of the Timaeus means being in place, as opposed to having an effect in a place. In De Chylo, Aristotle talks about the unmoved mover having an effect at the circumference of the universe. And he is certainly very clear that that doesn't mean that the unmoved mover is at the circumference of the universe as opposed to somewhere else. So the philosophical distinction between being at a place and having an effect in a place is well established in Aristotle. I think it's well established in Plato, although it's thematized. But you're assuming that there's only one possibility, that the soul must be at a place as opposed to having an effect at a place. If you, for example, were to say, God is the cause of my existence, and as cause of my existence, God is the sustainer of my existence, and so God is right here causing me now, it doesn't follow that God is here in a place.
No, that's a really good point. I do think, at least in the Timaeus, that there is clear evidence that, at least in the case of human soul, he thinks it is located in a space.
Well, that's what you're saying, but all he has to have is that it has an effect in a place.
I mean, he
just
does...
having a skedaste ousia means capable of having effects in multiple places, in the diaphragm, and the heart, and the head, and so on.
I guess I would read him in the Timaeus as actually saying that rational souls in the head, etc., but maybe I should just look again at those passages and see if there's support what you're claiming.
Thanks a lot for that, Susanne. I found it absolutely delightful. I just have a question. So I liked how you, I only had this thought about this not Cartesian in the Timaeus, and I very much liked it how you showed that we find a very similar picture in the Phaedo. But I was wondering, we have a difference in the Timaeus, namely that the soul is actually, if you want, composite, right? Which we don't have in the Phaedo, and in the Phaedo it seems to be a very important that it is not composite, because only whatever is composite can fall apart again. And so I was always puzzled, why does that argument not seem to apply any longer in Timaeus? Why, you know, is the soul not threat? I mean, sure, Demiurge says, I promise, but apart from that, you know, why put it in that danger? And I was wondering whether you have any thoughts about that.
Yeah, I mean, there's certainly, and I don't want to minimize the differences between the Timaeus and Phaedo, right? So also in the Timaeus, you have parts of the soul that are mortal, parts of it that are immortal, which perhaps he does not want to hold in the Phaedo. I don't have a line on that. I mean, one thing that I've thought about, though, is what were to take the term synthetos to mean in the Phaedo, at least, right? And it could mean either something that has parts, or the emphasis could be on something that's assembled out of parts, and you do see passages where Plato uses it in that way. So there's a passage in the Sophist that has to be read that way, and perhaps some of the stuff in the Republic, at the end of the Republic, has to be read in that way. So it could be, I mean, I don't know, I'm open to the possibility that there could be partite things that are not put together. That's not going to help with the Timaeus, though, right? Because there it is, both partite and put together. So I don't have a solution to that.
I wanted to ask about the metaphors of kneading together of the various ways in which the soul-body interaction is talked about. And it seems that those are metaphors of how that... Do you think that there's an importance to the particular metaphors that are being chosen?
Mm-hmm.
And the fact that he's using metaphors, is that... What does that say about exactly how he's treating this interaction? Because you seem to be pushing very hard for it not to be metaphorical.
Well, look, I think the reason my view obviously is going to be that the reason he chooses those metaphors is because he wants to convey a certain account of what's going on with body and soul, that he wants to, for instance, suggest that they do interact by contact. If he wanted to avoid that assumption, perhaps he would have used other metaphors. But I think there's another way that you could push your question, which is to say, look, I don't know, I'm not claiming that literally there are nails, for instance.
Yeah.
So if there aren't literally nails, then why not abandon all of the rest of it? And I think there it's just a tough interpretive call about how far you go with not taking Plato at his word. And I guess I think that, as actually Robinson puts it in his book, right, this imagery suggesting what he there calls the ectoplasm theory is just so consistent and fits together so well that it's hard to dismiss it wholesale.
Thanks for this. I really enjoyed it a lot. In the end, you had some remarks about the like goes like principle.
Mm-hmm.
I think mostly I just wanted to ask you to elaborate a little bit
more
about how that might work.
Mm-hmm.
Were you saying that perception works in part because the features of the soul that you highlight allow the soul to know features of material things, for instance, its extension?
Yeah. Oh, in the case of material things, I see. I haven't developed it in that way. So the way in which I was talking about it in my talk was, the claim was that the reason the philosopher is able to eventually know the forms is that his soul doesn't have a corporeal accretion, hence it becomes fully immaterial, therefore it's like the forms and it has some prior affinity required for knowledge. But I think you have a really good point that maybe we could push it another direction, right? That the reason the soul has this kind of hazy status where it can be entirely immaterial or partially material, et cetera. Or perhaps the reason he wants to emphasize that it has extension, location, et cetera, perhaps again is to provide some sort of prior affinity, thereby enabling knowledge of the perceptible world.
Thanks.
Thank you very much. And now we are going to listen to Cynthia Patterson. She's going to talk about the images of the metaphors. She has subtitles. So, metaphors of body and soul in the Phaedo, a view from the swamp of social history. And she is an history teacher, so we are really glad to hear you.
In his discussion... can you hear me? In his discussion of an immortality of the soul in the Phaedo, Plato Socrates employs three striking metaphors to illuminate the soul's relation to the body. The soul is imagined as enslaved to, imprisoned in, or shackled to, or polluted by the body. Other less highly charged metaphors are offered as well in the counter-arguments of Socrates' interlocutors. The soul is like the harmony created by a musical instrument introduced by Simmias, or from Kebes, the soul is analogous to the weaver who makes cloaks. But slavery, imprisonment, and pollution provide the dominant metaphorical images of the dialogue and are the focus of my paper. I come to this topic as a social historian interested in Plato's creative engagement with the cultural traditions and language of his contemporary Greek society. And my subtitle is inspired by Plato's depiction in the myth that closes the dialogue of the corner or hollow of the world in which he lived as a world bogged down with corruption and disease. We live, explains Socrates, around the sea like frogs or ants around a swamp, without realizing, or only rarely, the existence of a purer and healthier and happier realm on the Earth's true surface. So historians' business is what goes on in the swamp. Looking closely at the language with which Socrates or Plato expresses the mortal embodiment of the immortal soul as a kind of bondage calls attention to the social realities of slavery and bondage that undergirded Athenian society and created the context of Socrates' situation and Plato's narrative. At the same time, Socrates extended an imaginative use of language of pollution and corruption reveals and suggests the influence of contemporary medical and religious discussions of illness and disease on Plato's thought and supports, I suggest, the traditional interpretation of Socrates' final words, "Uiokaktos Kleithias," as an appropriate offering to the patron god of healing for the impending release and purification of Socrates' soul, metaphorically. The figure of Socrates, I think, draws together all three images. So first, shackles and bondage, prisons and cages. I begin with the physically and centrally vivid image of imprisonment, in Greek terms, being in bonds.
We can't hear you very well. The microphone, please. Yeah.
Okay.
Thank you.
Being in bonds or in shackles. Plato's narrative at the start of the dialogue calls immediate and explicit attention to this physical feature of imprisonment with its depiction of Socrates rubbing his leg, which has just been released from its shackle. It is not entirely clear just how imprisonment worked in Athens, and whether there was in fact what the archaeologists would call a purpose-built prison in Athens in which Socrates and other prisoners were kept, agora plans and tour guides notwithstanding. But what is clear is that imprisonment entailed the physical pain and public humiliation of being shackled. It was corporeal punishment, something from which Athenian citizens were in most cases protected. What we speak of as the Athenian prison, desmoterion, was given its name by the instruments, the desmoi, through which prisoners were held for trial, for execution after trial, as in Socrates' case, for surety of payment of fines, or in some cases as a penalty per se. The importance of Plato setting Socrates' final conversation or oration on the nature of the soul in the place of shackles is certainly well recognized, but emphasizing the physical nature and pain of shackling adds significantly to the impact of Socrates' use of this and related metaphors, for example, being in a cage or a pen, as he discusses the immortality of the soul. The metaphor of bondage first appears at 67d1 in close connection with the other two metaphors under discussion here, pollution and slavery. All three metaphors appear in this portion of the conversation. At 66b6, Socrates speaks of his psyche as mixed or kneaded with evil, sumpeformene, a metaphorical variant within the metaphor of contamination. And a short while later, he says that the soul, or using the personal voice, we are slaves, doulelontes, to the service of the body. At 67c4 to d2, Socrates brings this phase of the argument to a conclusion with a return to the imprisonment metaphor. He says, and does not purification, catharsis, consist in separating, so far as possible, the soul from the body and teaching the soul the habit of collecting and bringing itself together from all parts of the body and living, so far as it can, both now and hereafter, alone by itself, freed from the body as from desmoi. But if by chance we did not appreciate the physical force of the use of desmoi here, Socrates drives the point home a bit later at 82 D9 to 83 E4 with a related but somewhat different metaphor. True lovers of knowledge, says Socrates, perceive that when philosophy first takes possession of their soul, it is entirely fastened and welded to the body and is compelled to regard realities through the body as through a cage, diergmu, not with its own unhindered vision and is wallowing in utter ignorance. Here the imprisonment image is that of an animal in a pen or a cage, wallowing in not mud, but ignorance. Then philosophy itself, or herself, sees further that the most dreadful thing about the imprisonment, literally being in a cage, is the fact that it is caused by its own desires, so that the one imprisoned is the chief assistant in his own imprisonment. Summing up this image, Socrates asks, is the soul then not completely put in bondage by the body? To which he answers with a strong and vivid affirmation, each pleasure or pain nails it, the soul, as with a nail to the body and rivets it and makes it corporeal, so that it fancies that things are true, which are the body says are true. Plato's emphasis on the physicality of bondage in his use of the metaphor of the soul's bondage to the body makes then the opening of the Phaedo particularly striking and paradoxical. We encounter the prisoner Socrates with his leg just loosed from its shackle for the last time as he faces execution. And we also recognize a philosopher who has committed his life to the pursuit of virtue and to that extent already freed from the most significant sort of bondage and imprisonment. That's being ruled by bodily pleasures and pains and wallowing and ignorance that the dialogue goes on to detail. Further, Phaedo, the speaker, moves from noting Socrates' experience of both physical pain and pleasure in his leg as it is unshackled, to relating that Socrates was inspired by that experience to invent an Aesopic fable for the occasion, which a god attempts to reconcile the warring figures of pleasure and pain by fastening their heads together with his result for humans that one never comes without the other. And then we hear of Socrates' project of turning Aesop's mythoi into verse. By introducing the figure of the slave Aesop into the prison discussion, Plato also introduces the metaphor of slavery. So the second point, the slave condition and the soul. The introduction of Aesop into the Phaedo in this manner has seemed more or less significant to different readers of the dialogue. Recently, Leslie Couric has argued that the opening interchange is, she says, calls a programmatic passage in which Plato goes to some trouble to affiliate his prose dialogues with Aesopic fable and Socrates himself with Aesop. Using the late anonymous life, which dates at the earliest to the first or second century CE, Kirk develops this thesis that Aesop and his fables are an essential part of the cultural context in which or against which Plato invented the genre of the prose dialogue. We may or may not believe that Plato was aware of all the details of the depiction of Aesop developed in the life, such as that he was an extraordinary, ugly, Phrygian slave with a sharp tongue and a quick wit that was a match for his superiors and eventually won him freedom, but also his ignominious execution at Delphi. Nonetheless, as Kirk shows, some basic details of Aesop's life and fables were already established in the 5th century. Herodotus provides a bit of indirect testimony on Aesop's servile background, and a well-known Athenian red figure cup from the mid-5th century most likely represents Aesop in conversations with a fox. Here on the cup, Aesop appears as grotesquely disproportioned, although not snub-nosed and swarthy as in the life. Kirk's suggestion that Socrates' supposed ugliness evoked the image of the slave Aesop is to me less compelling than Plato's own comparison of Socrates via Alcibiades' speech in the Symposium to Silenus. But Socrates' evocation early in the Phaedo of the mythoi of the slave Aesop, which Socrates has now decided to put into verse, is certainly significant. Introducing Aesop effectively introduces the issue of slavery. And as much as the metaphor will be developed, challenged, stretched, use a term Jeffrey Lloyd, in the discussion to come, slavery is, as we know, not a metaphor, but a lived reality. Here it is important to note that the language of bondage already discussed connects directly with that of slavery. The deprivation of freedom of movement and the humiliation of being treated as cattle, shackled or yoked and penned, were essential and perhaps even the essential feature of the status of chattel slave in the ancient Greek world. The use of the term andropodon, man-footed, and related words for slave in analogy with tetrapodon, or four-footed, vividly makes the point. as does the frequent animalization of slaves in both literary and visual description. When in the Apology, Socrates considers counterproposals to his accusers' demand for a penalty of death, he considers but rejects the possibility of imprisonment, saying, "Why should I lie in prison, a slave to those who may be in authority?" The physical domination of the slave's body was what made possible the use of that body for service. And from this perspective, Socrates' connection of an imprisoned soul with a servile soul is in keeping with the realities of his society. When speaking of the metaphor of slavery, it is important to emphasize the power and depth of the image. There was in Plato's day an established semantic stretch, to use, as I said, a phrase of Geoffrey Lloyd, in the use of doulos and related terms. As I understand Lloyd's term, semantic stretch, the idea is that the metaphorical use of a term does not preclude its retaining the immediate power of the literal sense. We need not say that a word's use is strictly either literal or metaphorical, but can recognize that when words stretch in meaning, the immediacy of the literal meaning, here the physical reality of a person as thing, a property, is not lost but adds power to the stretched or metaphorical usage. So, for example, we find Herodotus and Thucydides clearly employing the metaphor, the political metaphor of douleia as servile subservience, and Aristophanes as clearly enjoying the comic possibilities of image in political contexts. But in what is more of a flip than a stretch, it's also possible for Plato to use the metaphor of slavery in a positive sense, as a proper and virtuous obedience to a higher or better authority. Herodotus, too, can use this implicitly when he has this demerit to say the Spartans consider the law their master. So the body is, or should be, by nature, the slave to the soul. And Plato represents Socrates, and I think one of the most extraordinary metaphors, saying that he is the fellow slave of Apollo, of Apollo's sacred swans, and like them, a prophet of the god. The metaphor of slavery has a greater and more complex resonance in Plato's contemporary world than there's time to investigate here. But in using the in making the metaphor of slavery critical to his discussion of the relationship of the soul and body, and in directly connecting Socrates with the ostensibly servile figure of Aesop, Plato heightens the reader's awareness of the paradoxical and marvelous character of his philosophical hero, who, despite his physically painful bondage and imminent execution, remains in control of his own soul and of the discussion at hand. So, finally, pollution and purification, religion and medicine. Geoffrey Lloyd introduced the idea of semantic stretch in relation to the discussion of the meaning of the term catharsis. And I find the notion of this stretch especially, especially helpful for understanding the semantic power of the third of Socrates' main metaphors for the body-soul relationship, that of pollution or contamination. Plato's idea is that in this mortal life, our souls run the risk of metaphorical contamination through contact or interactions with the bodies in which they live. We live, and this is a thread running through the dialogue. The idea already appears in Socrates' opening comments on the contaminated condition of the soul through intrusion of the needs and desires of the body. It continues to the more complex arguments about knowing forms and culminates in the mythic image of the cosmos with which Socrates concludes his discussion. Can this metaphor then explain Socrates' enigmatic last words, "We owe a cock to Asclepius"? Crito, pay it and do not forget. Is Socrates suggesting via a stretched metaphor of pollution and purification that as his soul is about to be finally healed of its bodily contamination by the separation of soul from body and death, an offering to the healing god is in order? Certainly many have taken his words in that way, but some have objected strongly that Socrates does not consider life as a disease to be cured by death. And nowhere does he ever adopt the view that life is an illness or that death is a cure, asserted Glenn Most. I'll skip a little bit here, but Most concludes that Socrates could not have considered his own death in any way some sort of seeming healing for which Asclepius could be acknowledged. I think this goes too far, because even if life is itself not a disease, living in the body can nonetheless be imagined as a source of metaphorical pollution and illness. In making his argument, he most insists on separating the language of medicine and healing from that of religion. Arguing that Plato uses the idea of pollution and purification purely in a religious context. Most says the register involved is in fact not medical, but religious. Most distinction, however, fails to appreciate, I think, that the remarkable verbal and conceptual overlap between ways of understanding and speaking about the body, health, and disease that was fundamental to both Hippocratic medicine and Asclepian cult of Plato's time. And this is the point which has been made authoritative by others, Lloyd, Philip, Van der Eyck, and R.J. Hankinson in particular, and need not be detailed here. Hippocratic medicine and Asclepian cult were contemporary, not antagonistic phenomena. They shared a common set of conceptual terms. It is evident, I think, that in the Phaedo, Plato seems especially interested in presenting Socrates as a figure whose analytical discussion was up to date and medically informed, but also deeply pious. Socrates' use of the language of contamination and pollution reveals this duality clearly. A particularly striking example of this contemporary resonance is in Socrates' extended vision of the fate and separation of the soul and body after death. Against the visibly decaying, but in some respects, so to speak, deathless body, Socrates sets the invisible and truly immortal soul. The latter may either depart pure and not dragging along anything of the body because it is not willingly associated with the body and its desires in its early life, or be weighed down and dragged back into the visible world because it had spent its time in the company of corporeal pleasures. The latter soul is still immortal, but because of its corporeal habits, is forced to flit about the tombs and monuments of the dead. One soul is pure, the other is not. Hippocratic writers do not generally use the dichotomy body-soul, but imagine the mind as a psychic faculty that might reside in the brain, or the heart, or in bodily substances such as the blood. Socrates also knows this perspective, recalling his useful question, is the blood what we think with, or air, or fire? None of these, but the brain provides sensation. The author of the on the Sacred Disease is especially eloquent in his depiction of the brain as a center of consciousness, perception, and judgment. It ought to be generally known that the source of our pleasure, merriment, laughter, and amusement, as of our grief, pain, anxiety, and tears, is none other than the brain. It is especially the organ which enables us to think, see, and hear, and to distinguish the ugly and the beautiful, the bad and the good, the pleasant and unpleasant. A disease which affects the brain, excess of cold, watery phlegm, has the most serious consequences. And we hear about catharsis of the excess phlegm being part of the way to produce health and a healthy consciousness. And I'm going to skip some other examples from Hippocratic writings here on breaths and on the diseases of young girls. And I'll just come to the conclusion here. I think that the separation of the two spheres is mistaken. Life itself is not a disease, but being alive. Continuing involves the possibility of disease as a disruptive movement or pathology of the body's constituent parts. And soul offered a genuine effective metaphor of Socrates' discussion of the nature of the soul. The bow to Asclepius is the final step is consecutive in the ritual which Socrates imagines at the end of his life. He is denied the opportunity to make a libation, but he makes a vow and then asks for the cot to be offered to Asclepius. I suggest that Socrates does thank Asclepius for answering his prayer for a fortunate death, and doing so calls upon the many layered meanings of the metaphors he used in the dialogue to argue for the soul's immortality and the necessity of the struggle to keep it a free and pure access to the better world. That is, his words activate the audience's association between catharsis and healing, disease and impurity, and the dialogue's connection found also in Hippocratic writers between impurity of the soul brought about by the body and the impeded psychological functioning. Therefore, in Plato's case, this psychological malfunctioning manifests itself in mistaken opinions about what is real, in wayward desires, and failure to attain full understanding, and I'll have to stop there. Thank you.
I'd like to say thank you to Dr. Cynthia Patterson, but I have a few questions. One is, do you see the parallels between the image, or between the myth at the end of the Phaedo and the image of the cave in the Republic? The main idea is the same. We are dwelling on a certain level of reality, being unaware that there exists something purer and higher than the place we are living in. The second, my second comment is about these images of body imprisoned, soul imprisoned in the body. I believe we meet this idea before Phaedo in Mino, the members of the myth. The people who participate in certain myth tell us, as if it were, our body was imprisoned in, our soul was imprisoned in our bodies. So probably the source is not the impression of Socrates' situation, but some religious group or movement. Orphan or not orphan, I cannot say. Last, the third thing is about the ugliness of Socrates and the ugliness of Aesop. I believe this is Nietzsche. This is Nietzsche, who Nietzsche was influenced very much by phrenology. And I don't think it is relevant to the antiquity. And the very last question, I don't think that Socrates and Plato were very concerned with slavery as such. What was important, the hierarchy, the subordination, the, what is inferior should be subordinated to what is more lofty, should be subordinated by the superior. And this is not slavery, it was taken for granted, in my opinion. But all these images indeed are very, very important and interesting in this aspect. This manner of considering this was very, very interesting. Thank you.
In a longer version, if I had more time, I would certainly talk about the cave. Mm-hmm. I think that the prisoners are shackled. Really interesting, and it's painful, and it keeps them. And the, I guess your point about the other ideas of the soul, the Orphic, I think you were suggesting Orphic, that also I think is important. The idea that Plato, Socrates definitely wrote the mysteries. It's an extremely rich background, that there are many ways to look at it. I don't know. I think that slavery. I think slavery is important, and I think what's particularly interesting is that the way in which Plato turns it around, and so it has the body should be enslaved to the soul, but in fact, we are enslaved to our bodies, and so there's a real tension. I think for Socrates to be in the position. Essentially speaking about slavery and bondage and the corruption of the world in our, I was going to end with something, the myth, I think it's this idea of being down in the hollows, soggy and corrupted is really important, that Socrates is here with us, but his soul he may be one of those who actually totally escapes and doesn't even have to be reincarnated. Just his soul will be released to the very top, not just to the top of the world where it's pure, but to the very top. But I think slavery is important because it's such a basic reality and fundamental part of the way.
Yes, I also think slavery is quite important, and in the dramatic dialogue that precedes this one, that the metaphor is used very importantly there, where the laws say to Socrates, you are a slave, and that image recurs. It's not just used the once, it's the language of, are you running away like a slave, you know, are you hiding in a sack, you know? And there's also ancient testimony that Phaedo was a slave and
yes,
was free.
I
think that's kind of an interesting connection there, that I think there is an element of this sort of liberation happening. So I was wondering if you could stretch the metaphor, how Plato uses it in the Crito.
I think that those are really excellent points, and they're part of a longer project. I think it's interesting that the idea that Herodotus already has that idea that the Spartans say, they don't say we're slaves, they say the slave is our master, but despotus always goes with doulos. So, but I think Plato makes it explicit, he builds on that in a way. So in the laws also, when the Athenians were slaves to the law, they had a good democracy, but then when they became too free, then they overthrew it. So I think that it's fundamental, and I think it's also imaginative of Plato pushing it. He pushes it beyond what his society did. But yet it was being stretched in his own world, but he stretched it further.
Thank you for that, Cindy. I love it when classicists enrich our understanding of the text, because philosophers tend to be very abstract in approach, and you've kind of made it concrete for us. I had several questions that your paper provoked. One of them was when I was listening to you talk about slavery and imprisonment, enchainment, pollution, the irony was borne in on me that in the Phaedo, these are situations that are self-inflicted. Is that not right? Would you agree with that?
That's right. That's what makes it even worse, is that you're doing it yourself.
That's right. Whereas usually slavery is not self-inflicted, pollution is not self-inflicted. Well, I suppose the chains of punishment and imprisonment, you could say, in a certain sense, are self-inflicted, because you do something that makes somebody do that to you. Do you want to expand on the irony of that?
I think that one thing it does make it worse is that it comes from oneself. And I think a cave, I don't know, how do the prisoners get to the cave? Is it something about being mortal that's part of the reality of being mortal, that we are in prison? So, more of a just basic condition.
Well, in the Phaedo, it's pleasures and pains.
Right. Which is what being mortal is, right? Having pleasures and pains. Or that's part of it.
Thank you very much. And now Marcelo Boeri is going to... Well, he's wondering if there is an interactionism between soul and body. So his paper is called To Act and to be Acted in the Phaedo. And I give you.
Okay, thanks. Plato says a number of times that in the active-passive relation, the material is the active ingredient, and the material the passive one of such relation. In the Phaedo, it is pretty clear that the soul is what sets a body in motion. But Plato seems to point out that both the soul is able to act upon the body and the body upon the soul. One might think that it is not entirely clear how the soul and body, despite being so different as regards their nature, are related to each other. My claim is that in the Phaedo, Plato suggests that some form of interactionism between soul and body is possible, and that in connection with that issue, he advances the view according to which there is a sort of codependence relation between soul and body. Moreover, such codependence, I hope, can be explained due to the fact that soul and body share a common feature. Both of them are capacities, and thus they are able to act and to be acted upon. In the next section, I discuss some passages in the Phaedo where Plato shows the power of the soul over the body, as well as that of the body over the soul. When discussing those passages, I will underline the sense in which I think Plato appears to endorse a certain kind of interactionism. I will also indicate how the fact that both the soul and the body can be understood in terms of capacities is helpful for seeing why Plato need not affirm that both relate our bodies for them to enter in a mutual causal relation. The view that the soul is the origin of motion is almost a commonplace in Plato. It even constitutes one of the basic premises of the famous argument for the immortality of the soul in the Phaedrus. Sometimes Plato speaks of one's soul as what is able to use and rule all the body, and because of its ability to rule, the soul is more valuable than the body. In the Phaedo, the argument to show the priority of the soul over the body runs thus. When soul and body are present in the same thing, nature ordains the latter to be a slave and to be ruled, and the former to be the master and to rule. The soul, in being incorporeal and dealing with the unchanging, is like the divine. But the divine is able to rule and to lead by nature, while what is mortal is able to be ruled and to be enslaved. If this is so, the soul is like the divine and the body like the mortal. There are some interesting points arising from this passage. In what sense can it be said that the soul rules and leads what is mortal the body? It appears to be easy to answer this question. This is a way of talking. I move my arm because I have decided to do that. In Plato's ontological map, deciding is a psychological item, so the soul is able to set one's own body in motion because the movement of one's body depends upon one's psychological state. This is what to rule over one's own body means. The body does not move by itself. The other interesting point is that Plato holds that to rule belongs to the nature of the soul and to be ruled to the nature of the body. Once again, one might easily understand this to mean that the body by itself is motionless. That is, the body cannot move itself and cannot set another thing in motion either. In other words, setting something in motion does not belong to the body, to the body's nature. But the most appealing point is that even though Plato provides this argument in favor of the soul as a moving principle, he explicitly allows that the soul can be affected by the body as well. In fact, the soul as a whole is dragged away by the body. So even though the soul uses the body to examine something, thus reminding us that the soul is that which is active, Plato asserts that the soul can be affected by the body. But if we are to accept his claim that the active role belongs to the soul, not to the body, how is it possible that the soul is dragged away by the body? Moreover, the soul itself, one thus becomes confused and dizzy, as if it were drunk. To be sure, the cause of the soul's being in such a state is the body, but this introduces, I think, a certain tension, because the active role is supposed to belong to the soul, not to the body. At this point, my suggestion is that Plato advances an idea according to which there is a sort of codependence relation between soul and body. Although the view that the active factor is the soul is not new in Plato, the passage in the Phaedo is particularly important. The soul uses the body to examine what it examines, and it does that through seeing or hearing or through any other sense. This means that the body is an instrument of the soul. So the preeminent place of the soul is clear. These lines of the Phaedo should be parallel with the former passage where Plato states that nothing we hear or see is accurate. When the soul attempts to examine something together with the body, the soul is or can be deceived by the body. This passage belongs to the first section of Plato's argument aimed at making plausible the view that the separation of the soul from the body is indispensable to avoid being deceived by the body. But the state that one would be in when one leaves aside the body can apparently be obtained with death. But Plato is cautious enough to neutralize our concern, my concern actually, with regard to the requirement to be dead in order to gain some wisdom, because he warns us that even though the soul cannot be completely separated from the body while the person is still alive, there is a way in which we can come closest to knowledge. This manner would consist in having no communion or association with the body beyond what is absolutely necessary. In fact, examining something together with the body is what we do insofar as we are alive. Of course, Plato's word that one can get rid of one's body just as far as one can. His argument for suggesting this is that the soul reasons best when known of the senses troubles it. Indeed, he assumes that the senses are embedded in the body, so maybe the solution is to develop a technique to neutralize the influence of the body upon one's soul and what is associated to it. But even within this framework, Plato heavily believes in the necessity of releasing one's soul from communion with the body in order to get what it is in itself. I skip the rest of this page and I go to the next paragraph. Now, the main thrust of the problem I'm dealing with is this. This is page 6 in my version. If by their very nature soul and body are so radically different, how is it possible to assert that soul and body can be acted upon by each other? That the soul acts upon the body is quite clear, since it is what sets the body in motion, but the soul also is acted upon by the body, since when it is under the body's influence, it wanders, gets confused, and is disturbed. According to the Phaedo, all the changes that the soul experiences because of the action of the body are for the worse. The soul is dragged by the body into things that never remain in the same condition. But this is possible because the soul that is liable to undergo such changes is an embodied soul pertaining to a weak person, maybe. One might suspect someone who is unable to deal properly with his or her body. The embodiment of this soul cannot be pure. To be sure, the fact that one's soul is embodied does not necessarily mean that one's soul is subject to be affected in a bad way. When an individual dies, his or her soul can be separated from the body either in a pure or in an impure condition. The former is the case of a soul that has spent its life not associated with the body at all, Plato says. Of course, when Plato asserts that such a soul did not spend its life associated with the body at all, it should mean that such a soul has not been subject to the governance of the body and its negative influence, irrational desires, for example. By contrast, a soul is in an impure condition when it separates itself from the body because it has been coupled with it, sought it, loved it, and so on. Indeed, there is a sense in which any soul has been associated with the body. Plato says that to examine something through the body is to do so through sense perception. By contrast, whenever the soul examines something alone by itself, it apparently gets rid of any contact with what is corporeal, and thereby one is not concerned at all with sense perception. But that cannot be the case, because Plato endorses the view that we can come closest to knowledge, quote, while having no communion with the body beyond what is absolutely necessary. The Platonic knower, so to speak, to some extent, has to deal with his or her body. Plato's point, I guess, is that the body should not rule over the soul. Otherwise, one cannot have wisdom. Thus, not even the wise person can remove the body from his own life, and this is so because one's soul is linked with it. But Plato's intention clearly is to point out that the soul that is in a pure state when leaving the body is the one that has not been ruled by the body and its desires. All of this constitutes a very well-known story for the readers of Plato's Phaedo, I've listed all these striking details to remind, once again, that Plato has no problem at all in advancing the claim that body and soul, in spite of being two items so different in nature, can relate to each other. One might tend to suppose that soul and body are able to causally affect each other because there is some commonality between them. But Plato, as convincingly argued by Professor John Dillon, did not regard relations between soul and body as constituting a real problem. In the Phaedo, Plato appears to take for granted that such relations obtain, and that those relations can be taken to be causal relations. The soul makes the body move, and the body makes the soul change. Despite the radical difference between soul and body, he does not see any problem in asserting that those souls whose states or conditions are impure continue to be somehow attached to the body when they separate from the body. In fact, when these kind of souls are separated from the body, they cannot get rid easily or completely of the corporeal, as it is shown by those shadowy phantoms or apparitions, a fantastic image of souls. But if the soul is more similar to the invisible than to the visible, it just can be seen because there still is something visible attached to it. This is the case of those souls that have not been able to detach from the body in a pure way, which should mean that they have not properly or strictly separated from the body. Now, if the soul is able to act upon the body and the body upon the soul, one might think that Plato had in mind what contemporary philosophers call interactionism, i.e. the view that material and immaterial things within a certain psychophysical unity have causal influence on each other. Such an interactionism must be conceived of in dualistic terms, that is, as the interaction of two things radically different in kind. There is no doubt that Plato sees no problem in admitting that soul and body are associated. Apparently, he sees no problem in maintaining that they have mutual causal relations either. And although he does not say that there must be a commonality between them in order to explain the manner in which they affect each other, we can attempt to find something which is common to soul and body. My conclusions, very quickly, I'm finishing. As I have already suggested, if the soul and body can be regarded as capacities, maybe one can find a commonality that is shared by both of them. The link between soul and body should be sought in what is common to them, and I believe that such a common factor is that both soul and body can be regarded as capacities, as they are able to act and to be acted upon. To some extent, this explains that they are interconnected, so to speak. When the soul acts upon the body is able to receive the soul's action, and vice versa. If both the soul and body are able to act and be acted upon, both of them turn out to be very plastic notions that should not necessarily be understood as entirely foreign or alien to each other. In Aristotle, this is quite clear, but it is not less clear in Plato, who in a well-known passage of the Sophists states that all that has the capacity of acting and of being acted upon really is. If this is so, and if the soul is the active item in the active-passive relation, one might assume that even in Plato, there is a certain codependence relation between soul and body. After all, it is Plato who asserts that there is no active without passive or passive without active. This is a fantastic passage in Plato's Theaetetus. However, this commonality between soul and body does not explain how an immaterial entity sets the body in motion or how a material entity is able to carry out a certain action on the soul. This is the task of Aristotle, another post-Aristotelian philosopher. Thank you so much.
Body or soul are dualities.
are you just assuming that because you're acted upon or acted or suffered, they are oppressed because of that? And second is the fact that the one suffers, one acts upon another, that this causes codependence. I can act upon this table, and am I dependent on this table?
No, the last part is very confused to me. Yes, I think there is a lot of evidence regarding your first question. For instance, in the Republic, Plato speaks of knowledge and belief in terms of powers, and he exemplifies with hearing and seeing psychological capacities, right? But in the Republic as well, he says that a good example of capacity is wealth and body. A body can be a capacity because a body is able to produce something in another body, for instance. This is good evidence, according to me.
But is this textual evidence of the use of the word dynamis to the body, or you're saying that the soul has capacities and the body has capacities, or they are, because if knowledge, sight,
okay,
these are capacities.
To say it in a very simple way, a body can be considered a capacity, not only because of the fact that Plato says that explicitly in that passage in the Republic, but also because the body is able to be acted upon. This is a capacity. I didn't understand very well the second part of your objection or question.
Question, objection. Why being acted upon or being acted upon implies codependence, as you argue? Codependence. Are there these two beings codependent from each other?
I see your point. Okay, you can say that within the Phaedo, for instance, aesthesis is thought within the realm of what is bodily, in a certain sense. For instance, if you think about the reminiscence argument, when Plato says that you first have to have a perceptual experience in order to remind of the forms, right? But I think this is very debatable, as everything. But this is very debatable. But even there, I think that Plato is suggesting that perception understood in a physical context, so to speak, the physical objects you can perceive, this is a trigger our analysis, right? But perception is not just that. Without the participation of your soul, there is no perception. This is developed by Plato in a chirurgical detail in the Philetus, for example. I'm not suggesting that Plato changes his mind in the Philetus, but he develops what he says in the Phaedo and other dialogues with regard to perception, and he introduces there in a very clear way the idea that aesthesis is not only a corporeal item but also a psychological item, right? But this is the Philetus, not the field.
Sordo.
Io.
Tu.
Bene, ma mi senti?
Sì, senti.
Senti, sono d'accordo con te nel considerare la interazione tra corpo e anima, e quindi corpo e anima come capacità, quindi non solo di ovviamente di subire, ma anche di agire. Il problema è questa doppia influenza. È una influenza da un lato negativa e dall'altro positiva, nel senso che l'anima, quando influisce sul corpo, si ha un risultato eticamente accettabile, quando viceversa il corpo influisce sull'anima e si ha un risultato non accettabile. Per esempio, nel caso della conoscenza, è impossibile giungere ad una conoscenza, alla verità, se ci serviamo del corpo, cioè se il corpo influenza l'anima. Giusto? Io mi chiedo, ti chiedo però, se è sempre così o se c'è anche una necessaria influenza o partecipazione del corpo a processi che sono esclusivamente dell'anima, come per esempio nella reminiscenza, nella anamnesi. L'anamnesi parte sempre ec aesthesis. Quindi una certa, diciamo, partecipazione del corpo, sia pure all'inizio, ad un processo della conoscenza che giunge alla verità, c'è sempre. Sei d'accordo?
Il professor Casertano ha parlato in italiano, posso parlare in spagnolo? Sì, è illegale.
Su questo.
Yo creo que el argumento inicial donde Platón, el argumento inicial que yo describí en la sección 79 y 80A, cuando Platón dice que cuando alma y cuerpo están presentes en la misma cosa, la naturaleza ordena al cuerpo ser esclavo, etc. No me suena muy metafórico, ¿no? Yo tomo bastante en serio esa línea, sobre todo por la presencia prescriptiva de la naturaleza. En general, en el contexto del Fedón, hasta donde yo me puedo dar cuenta, la influencia del cuerpo es pensada como negativa, digamos. Pero creo que es Platón mismo quien se encarga, dentro del Fedón, de neutralizar esa presencia, pero no de eliminarla. Yo creo que el cuerpo, para decirlo de una manera que Platón no lo dice, por lo menos en este pasaje, el cuerpo para Platón aquí tiene una función muy importante desde el punto de vista de una condición necesaria. Pero la idea de Platón en el Fedón, y creo que en muchos otros diálogos, es que el alma, en el caso de mi existencia, de tu existencia, no es algo que ande por ahí, ¿no? Independientemente del cuerpo, ¿no? Pero el secreto para Platón parece ser, ¿cómo hago yo como ser racional, ¿no?, para neutralizar las influencias negativas del cuerpo? Porque no todas las influencias son negativas, aunque Platón dice, ¿no?, que debido al hecho de que nosotros necesitamos alimento, ¿no?, esto nos lleva a ciertos excesos, ¿no? Es comprensible, ¿eh? Pero ¿no?, naturalmente uno no puede quedarse en ese plano, según Platón, ¿no? Ese no es el modo en que Platón cree que opera o debería operar un ser racional. Pero no, yo no creo que ni siquiera en el Fedón Platón esté interesado en eliminar la presencia del cuerpo. Por eso mi sugerencia del adelanto de lo que llamo la tesis de la codependencia, digamos, ¿no? Después hay que explicar naturalmente qué quiere decir eso, ¿no? O sea, ¿sí? Esa es la parte más difícil, naturalmente. Pero naturalmente, el alma humana en un ser humano que está vivo, naturalmente, no puede prescindir del cuerpo, ¿no? Aún en el caso del alimento que genera esta friaría y demás, ¿no? Es absolutamente necesario desde el punto de vista, digamos así, de un principio de conservación también, ¿no? ¿Qué sería de nosotros, ¿no?, si no tuviéramos hambre, por ejemplo? El problema para Platón en el Fedón, y creo que en otros diálogos también, no es comer o beber, ¿no? No beber agua, naturalmente, ¿no? No es comer y beber, es comer y beber en exceso. Una modesta respuesta.
Proseguiamo in questa
prospettiva romanza, ti parlo in italiano, va bene? In spagnolo non ci riesco. Dunque, Marcelo, è semplicemente per, è una modesta domanda la mia, semplicemente per richiamare l'attenzione sulla enorme concentrazione che io ho constatato leggendo il Fedone nella prima sezione, che è quella più importante anche per il tuo problema, dopo le catene, dopo Eveno di Paro, la prima sezione di impegno speculativo forte sul rapporto anima-corpo. Ebbene, in quella sezione noi abbiamo una concentrazione enorme di metafore per il verbo apto, apto mai, toccare. E sono metafore tutte applicate all'anima. Quando l'anima è sola, quando il corpo non c'è, l'anima tocca, tocca quella che noi chiameremmo dimensione ideale, poi questo è un altro problema del Fedone, ma tocca la realtà altra. Io vedo lì proprio nell'impiego così forte di questa metafora di apto una concentrazione altissima di metafore di apto, 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 ma è detto dell'anima, proprio la prova di quel che tu dici. Cioè l'anima, anche quando è ufficialmente staccata, poi tocca. E questa, secondo me, è la grandezza di Platone, cioè questa grande tensione che non viene mai risolta e che tu spieghi pensando poi anche al tuo Aristotele.
Io credo che hai ragione, ma in the passage I omitted in my paper, I mentioned that passage, because Plato uses the verb haptomai with regard to the soul, the way in which the soul touches its objects, and with regard to the body as well. This part of the diabolic Platonic method of doing philosophy, a great diabolic method. Wow. So it's very important.
I think there isn't in the corpus a similar passage for the frequency of the metaphor of apto, right. Apto, apto mai.
Oh, yes, I agree.
Fa l'amore, la Repubblica fa l'amore, l'anima fa l'amore.
I would like to make a last comment with regard to my use of the word dualism, because I know that some people here in this room, I'm thinking about the Trisposi, of course, and Giovanni Casertano, with regard to this new book, Senza Dualismo. I think that Plato was definitely a dualismo. However, by dualism, I do not understand a theory assuming a radical separation between body and soul. If what I have been suggesting here is more or less reasonable, you can understand that the soul cannot be totally separated from the body. Of course not. Is the use more or less common, not absolutely common, but more or less common in some contemporary philosophy of mind, when you say that A and B, A is the soul, B the body, are deeply different from an ontological point of view. But the mystery here is that Plato considers that they have a certain relation, a very important relation. That was my point, so don't get angry.
I agree with you.
All depends, as Fronterota says, on the way in which you understand what dualism is.
Yes,
it's a matter of
difference.
Linguistic matter.
Or horistos, that's the difference.
That's right.
Difference,
that's right.
Or horistos.
Yes. I don't think it's horistos in the Aristotelian fashion.
Yes.
I don't think Aristotle was wrong. Aristotle was criticizing Plato. Aristotle was a word that Plato didn't mean that. But that's another discussion. It's another seminar. No, Aristotle did understand what Plato said, in general. In particular, of course. In particular, too.
Not in particular.
Thank you.
thank you very much to all of you.